Hi, welcome everybody to another episode of Building Sight. We haven't had one for about 4 months, but I'm going to update you with some of the work we've been doing, in particular around developer experience, which I want to demonstrate today. So, without further ado, let's just move to our coding screen and we're going to fire up Emacs and we're going to run a version of Sight here, which we're going to do it the normal way when we're developing. We're going to open up deps.eden in the server directory and then we're going to jack in there. Okay, there is instructions in a PDF about how to do this without jacking in, and you can run a script which is in the bin directory here called site server. Okay, so I've set things up so site has a single command line in my path, so there I can type site, and this once you've got it set up, you should see a bunch of commands that you can run, and I want to explain what these do today. So first of all, I'm running site, but I'm going to reset everything that's in my database, and this is the reset, which is a dangerous command, so it has a confirmation dialog. It also has a kind of Mission Impossible countdown. So now if I run list, it's not ls anymore, it's list, it's empty. The database is empty. Okay, let us to initialize site with resources it needs, then to explain, you just do site init and that runs. It installs a few bundles, and at the end, it gives you some instructions. Now, what it's done is it's created a version of Sight in the database, create a set of resources in the database that has a client secret. This is this secret here, which is for this one. I can also get that with Sight client secret. I'll print it out to the console. This is really the secret that we need to use to authenticate ourselves with a client. We don't have any users at the moment, so we have to get this is what we need to, this is the only piece of authenticating information that Sight has. So let's do this. Now we do have a UI in the works called Insight, where we could just click on here and configure everything remotely via UI. Okay, well I'm gonna use the second approach where I can request a token. So I can copy and paste that, and this is where by default it's gonna use the client ID of this site CLI tool. Okay, so that's created an access token. I can now ask questions, like I can say, who am I? And here I'm the site CLI application. I don't actually have a user yet. I can check the token. It shows me my access token, it's a bearer token, and it uses this introspection. There's a bundle which is RFC 7662 that allows us to take the token, send it to an endpoint, and it will tell us information about it, particularly is it valid, is it active? Yeah. All those details are in this RFC 7662. And it also tells me in my time zone when this token is going to expire. And by default, the token has 24 hours. Okay, so let's do something else. We're going to now add a user that's going to represent me. So I can do that with register user. I'm going to now give myself a username. I can give myself other information. Quite arbitrarily, I can say, I don't know, my favorite color, which is orange, telephone numbers, that sort of thing. It's all schemaless, it's going in a schemaless database, so we can put anything we like here. But I do have to enter my password. Now, I can do this with, for example, input password, so you can't see my password. So I'm going to type the password in there. Now, why are we using passwords? Well, on the command line, this is a command line experience that We're not going to be using a browser, and therefore we can't use any of the other OAuth2 code flows, grant types such as auth code or implicit. So we're going to be using the resource owner credentials grant, which is known as the password grant. Now all the grant types, all the default grant types are supported by Scite. So we're using this perhaps temporarily while we spin up get a remote user spun up, and then we can perhaps use a UI. Okay, that's not enough. I need to also assign the user a role. So let me just explain what's going on here, so we can find out which users are in the system. Now I can request a token on behalf of that user. So I'm going to do username Mel, and now it's asked me to put my password in. Now if I say who am I can see that I'm Mel, and say who am I minus V, which is going to give me, well, I'll push that through JQ, so you can kind of nice colorized output. And there we are, you can see my favorite color is orange, and you can see my full name is Malcolm Sparks, and this is in the database. Can I do site users? I can't because it's forbidden. I don't have the right to call that endpoint. There is a selection of endpoints, but don't have access to that either. Don't worry, we can go back to the previous request token, putting in the client secret, and now we can find the users, and there we are, we can find the API endpoints that I've access to. Mostly by default, these things output JSON. You can also, if you want, you can output Eden. I think you can do this, and that will give you in Eden, which we can style with Jet. Don't have Jet on my machine. What else can you do now? So if I'm say, who am I? I'm the application. I'm going to assign a role to Malcolm, you, myself. And I've put in a role here, admin. Everything in Scite is all kind of data driven. And for the system API endpoints, I've decided to make some of them role based access control. And so it's just changes to the data log, which is in these operations. I'll show you that later on. So here we're going to give Mal the role admin, and so now I can go back into request token, type in my password, and now I should be able to say, okay, well, who are the users? Now I have admin user, right? I can now register other users. So let's register, I don't know, let's put Alex in here. Davis, don't know what his favorite color is, but I'll give him a password. Right, can I register the user? Oh, no, it's because I didn't give a password. Right, so let's give a password. That 500 internal server error may have been a validation error. It should be 400, maybe because the password didn't meet the password rules. So I'm going to put another super secure password in for Alex. So now I can, who am I actually? I can register a user, and I can now get my endpoints. I can do stuff, but let's go in as Alex. Put in a password for him. Now I'm Alex, and what can I do? Well, I can't get the API endpoints, and I can't do anything on users. But I can do some things. In fact, if I do who am I minus v, you can see that it will tell you which operations I'm allowed. So I'm allowed to do who am I. I'm allowed to introspect a token. Oh, let's do that then. Site check token. Hey, and that's my access token. Now the access tokens, well, that really should say it's active. Not quite sure why it doesn't. That should say that it is active. Yeah, so that's a bug. Let's go back to this request token for me. And let's check my token. Yeah, that's also not active. So it may be these access tokens which are granted on the password flow may not be compatible with that RFC. We'll go into that. So that really is the state of the developer experience if you're starting from scratch with site. That would be ideally a site instance would just be set up for you. In fact, we've got an AWS CloudFormation template that will get you just the enough of an installation with the bare resources, and it will give you the client secret. If you remember, you can use that then to go on and configure it. So it's a fairly fast out-of-the-box experience. You don't need to be running the server on your machine. But by default, the config is such that you configure things locally. So let me show you that. These are localhost resources. I can actually zoom in on one if I want. So let's have a look at my, I'll say find mail and find me. This is my username. This is my representation of that resource in Eden and JSON. So let's have a look at that. And we have pipe that through. Now I think we can do this. Yeah, we can. So this is a colorized JSON of that represents me. And if I was to go to this resource, I think we can do that with curl. That's possibly that will work. Let's pull this one, get this over here. And then there's a method not allowed. Oh no, it's not that, it's actually this one that I want to get. This is the operation that will be called when we do get. So let's do that one. And there we are. This is everything to do with Mal. Of course, if I was Alex, would I be able to see that? Let's try. Was the operation. Yeah, forbidden. So Alex can't see all my personal details unless he was an admin. I think I'm getting this not because I'm the owner of the resource, whatever that would mean, but I'm getting this because I'm the admin. Okay, so what are we showing here? Well, this is site pretty much complete in the sense that it has all of the access control stuff I was working on last year, that is all working, and it's throughout the whole system, and it seems to be working fairly reliably. There's another thing I'd be able to get here. I can see the events of everything that's happened in the system. Let me show you that. So I won't be able to do that as Alex because I haven't given him any privileges. So let's request token me, and now I can show the events. We're going to get quite a lot of events here. I wonder how many. Lots. A lot of stuff here. So let's have a look at perhaps the last one. This is when I requested an access token. So I called that operation. This is event 4727. That relates to the transaction ID. All right. Yeah, so that is me doing a single operation, 4727. I don't have a way. That's the transaction ID. This is the type, which is an event. These are the resources that were put by the event, so I could have a look at one of those. Let's have a nose at that. Let's do. No, that one. Right. Method not allowed. Because, yeah, perhaps I'm just not allowed to look at a subject directly like that. Or a refresh token. I mean, these are all resources, but they would need, oh, we could find that. That's what we could do. So I could do site find 700 there. That'll probably be enough. Yeah, here we are. And that, you see, is a resource, but it doesn't have any methods on it, declared on it. So, you know, method not allowed, but it's still a resource. It has a URI. And if we wanted to, and we could construct these things with methods, and so you could kind of drill down and get them. What else can we see? The time that this was done, the person who did it, which is, that is interesting because that's, oh, that is null, but I don't think it was null. It was definitely done by someone. No, that it wasn't, because getting a token is done anonymously. This create access token, even if I was to remove my access token, so now I'm nobody. I can, oh look, it's telling me I'm unauthorized. I can still have a look. Right, okay. Right. If I'm nobody, I can still access some operations. I can't get in that way. Perhaps I need to allow anyone to call who am I, and then see what operations a normal person is allowed to access to. Let's try that one. No, we can't see that one either. Okay. But the point is that this. Oh, I know what we could do. We could find. Yeah, we could find that create access token operation. Let's show you what that. Oh, right. Gotta log in. Let's log in as me. Okay. We can find that operation. Oh wow, that's big. Let's have a look at that. This is the operations code. And we can have a look at this. This is the input schema when I call it. What we're looking for here are the rules. The rules here is saying that. It's not really easy to see it in JSON. I'm not sure I can pull it out as Eden either. No, I can't. However, we just this rule here allowed means that essentially, anyone can see it as long as there is a permission, and there is a permission. If you look at the access token, you see this is the permission that links to the operation. This is what allows anybody to call create access token. And so there isn't a subject, and therefore the subject is null. Let's have a look at a little bit another event, perhaps. Find one where the subject isn't null. So this one, what happened here? It happened 10 minutes ago. We were introspecting a token. Who did that? This subject did that. Let's find out. Was that Alex? Or was that me? So we can do find that one. And yeah, this is user is Mal. We can find that one as well, and that's me. So I was able to say I am able to, with site events, be able to query who did what, and all of these events happen one after another. They're all one at a time. They all follow each other in a linearized way. So just a The system does record and is very open and records everything that's happened to it, and that information is held securely. So we have security, OAuth2, the OpenID stuff works, the OpenID Connect stuff where you can kind of link in Other things like Auth0, that stuff works. So it is a, well, quite a capable platform. I think you can call it, I used to call it a backend as a service, but I've gone off that idea. Well, it's, backend as a service strikes me as something that is in the data center of another company, and it's provided to me as a service. I really like the idea that I own my own data, that I or I'm in a company and the company owns its own data. And so, not really backend as a service, but definitely the word platform. And we've been, popular. There's a popular buzzword at the moment called platform engineering, where companies are taking a step back and saying, you know what, it would be really good to have a consistent platform that all of our development teams use that has a set of core properties or characteristics, because we don't want all these teams reinventing the wheel all the time. So what wheels are we always reinventing? Well, reinventing HTTP error codes and error handling, HTTP kind of APIs, security, logging in, access control, all of these things are continually reinvented. So with Scite, it's a case of, say, here's a platform that has all of that stuff just built in, battle tested, and it works. But you still get to write code, and you get to write code in the operations. And the operations, like, just zoom in on operations, find an operation to talk about. Let's look at this get user operation, or click through. So what does this tell us? Hey, so this is some code which says, well, the state of the operation is we run this code. I'll probably have to show you what that operation looks like in source code control. So if we have a look now at this, what is it like to develop against Scite? If you're a developer and you want to write an operation, what does that look like? So let's move things towards that. So I'm going to pick on this operations get user. So it's localhost 4440 on this installation, but it might be auth.acme.com on your installation. So the code talks in terms of example.org, and then the resources get transformed just in time when they get installed. So auth example.org just happens to be where this operation is, get user. So here we have a look. We look at operations, which is down here, and then we're looking for get user, which is here. Okay, so let's move that away. Let's look at the main thing is this is saying that the get user operation is created with this operation called create operation. It's kind of operations all the way down. But the key program here that we're looking at is this. This is the program that is going to run when this operation is triggered. Again, how is it triggered? Well, I kind of have to go a little bit deeper into another resource. When we call it, it's this users. This is the endpoint. This is the actual resource, what we call when we want a list of users. And here we have some OpenAPI metadata. But here, it's this is the post. This is the get, an operation called get users. As you can see, this thing on the right. When we do a get, is the operation that we just called, which is an operation is just another resource, and an operation has rules, access rules. If somebody has access to the operation as a result of these rules, then you get through the security. If you don't have access according to these rules, you'll get a 403, and if you're not authenticated, you'll get a 401. Okay. So let's dig into this. This is saying I'm going to do a database. I think it does a database query. I'll have to do one. So it will say group all the users together. Yeah, this this is saying group by reference is out. Oh, this is a function. And the user ID is, well, it, you know, this operation get user is used in number of cases. In fact, it's get users, isn't it? So let's have a look at get users. Right, here we are. And this is doing a database query where we're doing a pull syntax, pulling out everything that we know about a user. But we are only interested in resources where the type where it has this kind of type on here. And then we want the first projection. And then here we're saying we don't want to present this stuff. I don't know why we want to remove that stuff, but you know we do. And we sort it by the ID and then turn it into a vector. So that's what happens when you run users. Okay, so this is what it looks like to code. Now, if I was to make changes to this, this is all, this get users is all in a bundle. Let me show you the bundles. And it happens to be, oh yeah, it's in this bundle called users API. Okay, that's all right. So this is the operation. And what we do is, in order to install code into site, we do site install. I better check who I am now. Yeah, it's still now, so I should have access to this. I might not. I might have to. We'll see. We'll see. Install just site users API. Oh yeah, and that worked. So let's test that. Let's do site users, and you can see you get everything about them. Let's make a change to that program. Get users, and let's just not do that removal of certain attributes, see what that happens. So let's reinstall, and now let's do, yeah, now we get much more stuff. I guess I took this out because it was quite clutter, but still, these are special named attributes, job sites, they're sort of reserved and they kind of are meaningful to sites. So this is how a resource is given, a resource is given its restful configuration and state. So the configuration here is, these are the methods, this is just arbitrary data here, and this is a special one that site recognizes, which is the type of the resource, and this is its URL. That's great, two users in the system. And then we want to kind of, you can put that back, install it. And this is, by the way, this is transactional. If you're doing a bundle and one of these resources fails to apply, let's say you've got a compiler error, I guess it could be fake compiler error. We could call that 123, and I think that, no, I'm not sure if that's enough to make it fail. I think we'll end up with, let's just install that. No. Now when we do that, we'll get an internal server error. I know what that is. We can have a look at the log. I haven't got a log API in this just yet, but the logs are in, they're all in, they're all down here. So if we have a look at that log, we'll see that this is to do with user 123. Gosh, we need a lot more log than that. Okay, let's have a look at that. Yeah, could not resolve symbol user 123. So that's a decent error message. Now there is some talk about, because this is Babashka, or you know, this is kind of closure, but it's run through the small closure interpreter, which is a part of or core of Babashka. There's no reason why we can't have some help for running this code, debugging it outside of site. But it is a transaction function, and it is in a very nice language. If you look at the languages that often you get to use if you want to put code inside the database, this is a very nice syntax. Anyway, let's go back, fix the error, Let's go back and install it, work, and then we can do site users again. Okay, good stuff. How does the roles thing work? Well, actually, if we look at that get users, you'll see down here that this is where we put get users here. We've got a permission that assigns the get users operation to the role of admin, and that's how it is. So we should be able to see one of those. Let's just define some permissions by role. So this is the permission object. So these permission objects or documents, they're still resources like anything else. They're built, but they're like little switches. Their purpose is to be able to be easily removed. And in fact, in the XDDB database, they exist perhaps for a period of time, a validity period. They're valid for a time interval, which means that you can like give somebody the permission just on a particular day of the week, or you could give them a temporary permission for 90 days, that sort of thing. Right, so that's all done. And this is completely arbitrary. I could have chosen to get users to secure it with all kinds of different rules. I just decided to use this kind of role-based access control that I rolled myself, excuse the pun. Okay, I think that really shows what's going on. Now we could have a look at coding some of this stuff now. We did have a snag where we had the check token wasn't working. I wonder why that's not working. We have a look at that. So let's go from first principles. What's happening when we do check token? Well, see that we have to look at this site CLI. When we do site on the command line, it actually reruns a thing called Babashka, but with this config of site CLI. So then it calls into here, and then it says, well, we run check token, and that's gonna call this task, which is in this source area here. So we can have a look at check token. There it is. So first thing that we do is we retrieve the token. This could be cached. Tokens are by default, they're stored in Perl RC, which is pretty handy, right? Because then you can do things like, I don't know, you can do this. I'm not doing that operation, doesn't matter. Let's find something that I can look at. Let's look at Alex. Do that. And there's. I don't think I can give it a. Let's see if I can get it in Eden. No. It always gives me JSON. Yeah. Well. Let's find that. What is it? Always gives JSON. No, we have an Eden. We have. Right, so that feels like a bug to me. Got JSON there. So let's have a quick site find. There is an Eden resource. Actually, that looks to me like a copy and paste error. So let's find out what happens when we, how does the registration of the user actually works if we put in a new registration of Alice here. So going back to our site CLI, I'm going to push back to master because I was kind of just on a branch there. We'll just make sure the tests pass before we're kind of doing any code. We're going to spin up a branch and we're going to call this, is going to be a fix user content type. We're going to look at register user, which looks at this register user and tasks. There we are. And that calls a post on site users. This is in the data host. So we go into here, we look at the data host, look at site, and look at users, and there should be a post here. There's a post operation called put user. Let's have a look at that. That's where I think the bug is. So we're going to put that operation. You're often going between endpoints and then operations. It's just kind of the design of it. Operations are still resources, but they are a site concept that is very, very kind of built into site at this point. So here we are. We are creating a user here. So this is this program. This is running just ahead of the transaction. This is preparing stuff, ready to submit the transaction on the transaction log. And it kind of does all the work. Like there is an argument to saying, well, you shouldn't be able to regenerate the user Alice, and therefore in the transact, when you've got the most up-to-date access to the database, you can say, hey, does Alice already exist? Because I don't want to overwrite her. Or if I do want to overwrite her, I might want to check an if matches request header, which is this concept in HTTP called conditional requests. So it's a mechanism in HTTP to avoid lost update problems. So what would happen is if somebody else had recreated Alice, I might want to be able to say, hey, I know that this Alice exists and this is the etag for her, but I want to change something to do with Alice. But if somebody's already changed something else to do with Alice and I'm late to the party, I want the thing to say, look, you've got to go back and Bob over here has already changed Alice. You need to synchronize with that before, and then if you want, you can resubmit the change. That's to prevent Bob finding out, ah, Malcolm's just overwritten Alice's details without telling me. Okay, that was a little bit of an aside. So we're looking down here at the, here we are, these are the things that get created. This is just one big program. I can't really explain. If you don't know a closure syntax, this is not the time for me to teach you closure, but it's a super nice language. So what's happening here is that we're creating this common variant. Oh, I think I know what's going on now. We're creating this user here as some respond program. Ah, right. This. We're sort of saying there's two variants. So this is like, oh no, this is like the base, right? It's not the variant. And then what do I mean by a variant? Well, with content negotiation, a resource can have variant resources. These are other resources that can provide a representation for the resource in a different format. So in this case, we've got two variants. Three resources overall. We've got the original resource, and then we've got the the JSON representation of that resource, and the EDEN representation of the resource, three resources. So this is the reason, the problem with the problem. Here, this one is actually just the JSON stuff here, right? Okay. And this one is the Eden one, which is where we, well, I just like print that. Yeah, content link is the same. It's just the content that's going to be a bit different. Actually, I want to just put a new line at the end of that. Okay. Right, I'm happy with that. Now I need to reinstall this bundle. This bundle was the user's API bundle. Like that. Okay. So before I register a new Alice, I'm going to do site install. Now we're going to register Alice again. Register user. Password. We're just going to mark on Alice. Okay. And full name Alice. Okay. Why did I get an internal server? Let's have a look at the log. Oh, validation failed. Right. It might tell us a bit more. Yeah, it's saying password has to be minimum 6 characters. Now, it's, in fairness, that's not a great error message, like internal server error, but there may be a way, in fact, there would be a way of inside the validation to returning a 400. Well, we could do that, but hey, let's just focus on getting this done. I'm going to make a password Alice123. Okay, so Alice is in there now. So Mal and Alex will have to be recreated, because when they get created, this is when the resources are. Let's have a look at, let's find Alice. These resources are created at the same time Alice is created. So it's kind of too late for Mal and Alex, but these at least will be correct. So let's take that one. Let's do perl minus I. We'll get Alice. Bang. We're getting the Eden version of Alex by default. Okay. If we do get the JSON, we can get the JSON directly. We can get the Eden directly. And we can go and get the trigger the content negotiation. Look at this. This is a content type of Eden. Now watch those headers. Now we have, because we haven't specified, specified an accept header either, but that's okay. We're getting Eden by default, and it's saying the content location, is the header which is going to tell you the location of the resource that would give you the same representation if one exists. It will also say that the content negotiation algorithm varies on the accept header. So let's put the accept header in. So let's try and get the JSON version by doing an accept header. That worked. That's good. We're still negotiating content, we're still at the content negotiation one. If we go back to the Eden one, we don't get a vary header, because this is only the Eden one. It's just the doesn't have content negotiation on this. It might sound completely confusing, but this is exactly how the specification asks you to do things. And content negotiation can, in some sense, some situations, be really, really useful, particularly if you're having to serve XML or stuff, legacy clients or different versions of stuff. It's just, it's a kind of useful trick to have up your sleeve in case you need it. Site has always supported content negotiation because that's kind of where it's come from. Its site has come from a very principled implementation 3 or 4 years ago of HTTP, one single kind of handler to rule them all. So it does do HTTP pretty well, although it's not perfect. Okay, so we did see a bug there. The bug was that I really prefer to have JSON by default when I go and ask for Alice. I don't want to see Eden, but I'm getting Eden. Why is that? Well, there is something called, if I just go into here, there is, think it's called, it might be called wait. Gosh, I can't remember what the thing is called. It's, no. I know if we look at you get users, that might show us. That's the thing about streaming. You kind of sometimes these puzzles hit you and you can't remember. Let me downgrade. Come on. Ah, quality of source. That's what it was. Quality of source. Oh, well, that's not showing you there. Right. So this is a trick. You can because. The content negotiation algorithm uses PIC, which is a Jux library I wrote about 3 or 4 years ago, can't remember. But you can so go back into our put user, and here with the Eden one, we want to put a little Jux PIC quality of source. I'm going to say 0.5. Which is a little marker to say to pick that you should choose by default it's one. So by saying 0.5, it gets multiplied by the Q parameter. I'll show you that. So let's just reinstall that. So we said site install Jux site. What was it? Users API. And by the way, the new I've got the version of my laptop actually has some completion for these packages, which is super useful. I haven't done it on this desktop machine. So, right, okay, so now we'll go back and we'll see what do we get if we just ask for Alice? Ah, oh, we need to recreate Alice, right? Because, yeah, okay, we've recreated Alice. We're getting Alice, and now we're getting JSON by default. Perfect. We can set an accept header to say that we would like to get Eden, please, and then it will give us Eden. You can look at the content type if you don't believe me. But you can do things like this. You can say, well, I would prefer Eden. Yeah, you can say, I accept JSON, comma. I'd say, but I have a slight preference for Eden. And this is giving you JSON because it really wants to give you JSON. This is the thing by saying quality of the source. Site doesn't, in this resource, it doesn't consider Eden to be a high quality source unless you explicitly ask for it, right? But if you accept JSON, it's going to want to give it to you. Unless if I put 0.4 in, it's giving you Eden again. Watch this, right? And if we put 0.6 in, gives you JSON. What's going on? Well, you can see it's got something to do with this quality of source getting multiplied by the Q parameter of the of the accept header. Well, that's really down in the bowels of PIC and how that works. But it does give you kind of the ability to mark a representation as kind of more favored. It's particularly good for like making sure JSON comes out by default. Okay, I think that worked. We need to run our tests again. Oh, which are in the server. All the tests are in the server directory. Okay. So I prepare a commit. We can say that fix event representation of a user. That will do. I think I'll just merge that. Perfect. There was another snag. What was that? I didn't make a note of that. No, I'll probably remember another time. Okay. All right, so we have a version of site that is able for you to manage users, all that stuff. And there's a system API, right? So this is. But what we'd like to do is be able to allow you as a developer to write your own operations. Well, we can do that today, but want you to expose those operations as a nice open API Swagger document so you can publish your API and get other people to use it. So that's kind of the last piece that needs to be worked on. I mean, you can deploy stuff today, but right now the kind of only interface is this. API operations thing that isn't really giving you the Swagger document. So thinking about that, we'll go back into our other branch here, Open API, and yeah, I'm going to just rebase. Right, cool. We've got this. Just commit there, and I'll run the tests. Okay. Well, let's do some hacking then, right? Let's work out what we're going to do. Everything starts with bundles. So, right, we want to put some resources into our database. Everything inside, everything is a resource. And every resource gets created by an operation, except of a very, there's about like four resources at the beginning. In the bootstrapping, but So I used to have this thing last coding site had this thing called a system API. This was getting quite big and unwieldy, so I commented it out. It does still have the scopes in here though as well. I won't get into scopes now, but they're useful. Okay. Yeah, and as you can see, like this site thing is itself like this. If we say site find applications, this is the same non-privileged or as privileged application as anything else. So you have to register it, and these things have client secrets if they're confidential applications and blah blah blah, you know. And there is an API to allow you to register applications. You can also register applications just by installing them as a bundle. So let's have a look at that one, right? So if we say, okay, we've got an application here called, what was this one? Right, so that's under this applications insight. So this is in the tree, and in there's one, the idea of this installers, although I'm going to rename that, right? But it's one huge tree. Think about it as a monorepo of all the resources that can possibly be in any site instance in the universe. And for this way, you avoid conflicts. So it's probably going to be some mega Git repo somewhere. But you could perhaps register branches of that tree. It's just like one great big space. And it's purposes that to, you know, a greater or lesser degree, URIs can be stable then, and people aren't going to keep on kind of reinstalling apps in different places. And anyway, we'll see how long that idea lasts, but I think it's pretty useful. Right, so this is an operation called, like, this is going to create this insight. Eden, this is an application, and it sits there. Calls register application. Okay, you can make that register application available to just developers or just for anybody or users or whatever, right? So that's your choice. Of course, you will want to make your own choices in so far as what the rules are for this. So like you we will need kind of have private trees, but anyway. So for bundles, for this bundle, we're going to need some sort of OpenAPI bundle. Right, I've got this install OpenAPI root. So the idea here is that this is an operation this that allows you to put a pet store or your own API at some point. So let's see how we'd use that. Let's say pet store. Imagine you have an OpenAPI.json file there. That's going to have some dependencies. Let's find. Going to have this subject. I mean, I don't know whether this subject system is going to survive because it's actually overwritten, but the subject of the person is actually calling the operation or the application, calling the operation. So the idea here is that you'd say, hey, right, well, in order to create this resource, you're going to call this operation called install OpenAPI root. Okay, and there'd be some input, whatever that means. Anything that we need. So the idea is that we can call this install OpenAPI root. Now we need to define the operation. So if we before we let's just create this like let's call it pet store. Jobs demo pet store. I'm just going to call it pet store for now, I think. This has some resources attached to it, which will be pet store openapi.json. So when we call this pet store, when we install it, so install pet store. Great. Internal server, but that's fine. That's probably fine. Let's find the log. Let's run it again. I'm going to load it up in Emacs. I think I know what this is. Right. It's not very easy to tell from the code, from the error, I mean. So let's have a look at its operation, which was, I think it's called install OpenAPI root. I think this was the problem. We're just returning an empty map. I'm gonna put in a resource. It does have an ID in the body, so which has to be. Oh, this is neither here nor there because it's not there's nothing in the code that's asking for that. Okay, so what we're saying here is that there is some ID that's going to come up through the body. So when we call this, we're saying, hey, right, well, here's the input. Here's a special thing that we can do. Hang on, just find. What did I do there? Yeah, we can say as input to this, we're going to give it this ID. So then we can say, can you just the ID of the body here? The body is this kind of input, and that's okay. And then we can do something like just HTTP be think we can give it a hey, we'll just make a message to do. Okay, I'll do. This becomes the prepare earmuffs, and then when it gets transacted, it gets put into the database. So this has to be a proper resource. So we need to do, I think it's called API operations. So we need to install API operations. No, that didn't work. Oh, not a great error that. Okay, and then we can install pet store. Another and it doesn't help me to be doing this completely without any examples, so I'm having to work this out from first principles, so this shouldn't be reflective of the developer experience. So I can do a log here. Okay, that looks like it. Body is body, and I need to then probably slurp that body in because that's an input stream. So we can make it a string, and then we can read that string in. I like to see what I do with something else. So it says, all right, if you're eating. You do this. Okay. Read string. Right. And then you might validate an input. Okay. Which I won't do here. Okay. So let's try that. Let's roll out. That seemed to work. So we should have in here, well, should have in the log, something that will say, maybe after that one, won't it? Here, body is blah, blah, blah. Right, okay, that's good. And so we should also have this site find OpenAPI JSON thing. Yeah, we do. That's what we just put in. Wow. So you can see that developing this is working with the database. There is no time at which the database isn't a factor in here. It's not like you're kind of working with the database. And all of the, there are pros and cons with this approach. I was reading about something that was using, which is quite similar. Smalltalk had this feature where everything was just stored in the database. So it feels a bit like that. Anyway, let's put in something. Okay, we've got our open API to do, right? This should look no, yep. Okay. What am I thinking? I'm just thinking that we want to. This has got to look like a resource that is going to have some methods to it, so that we can do what we want to be able to do is this: curl that thing. Right, and we can't, right? So that's the next step, to make that method allowed. And the way that we do that, if we look at one of our, is that we put in something like that. And it can have an operation and some metadata. This is not going to be, yeah, if we have a look at our, at that one, that has a, that should have a type on it. Yeah, it has a type of API endpoint. This isn't an API endpoint. This is going to be an open API document. I'm going to put that in there. Just docs site type is going to be like that. We use this kind of well-known meta.jocs.site. It doesn't exist, but it will do one day. Doesn't have to. We're going to say this is an open API document. Okay. We're going to put some methods in here. And the method, I'll just put a juxtaposition description. I think there is an operation somewhere. That's right. That allows you to get an open API document. This is kind of what we need. I don't think the permission is correct, but anyway, if we look at that, that is giving everybody the ability to call get open API document. Let's just do that for now. Let's install that. This is the code that we already have. Wrote this some while ago. It's going to call out all the endpoints. I don't think we wanted to do that. Question is, do I want to this is the swagger to the pet store. And ideally, we want to be able to import this and have it generate our endpoints. So therefore we need this API, open API document. So put yeah, I think that's okay. I think we don't need this install OpenAPI root. Compare that with the put OpenAPI document. Fear that we're sort of just rewriting it here. So really, what we want to do is instead of install API root, don't want that install API root. We will just say that the pet store, which is here, this is just calling operations OpenAPI document. Okay. So in the bundles we have OpenAPI, okay, and we have these two bundles. So these create the operations, and this creates the API. Okay, let's try and install those two. Possible, we're going to be able to do the second one because I think there's a permission required to be able to do that, which will be can I put. Yeah, I won't be the system user, I'll be Malcolm. Anyway, we can fix that. So let's, can I install OpenAPI? Yeah, I can. Okay, now can I install system API, OpenAPI? So this would be similar to Pet Store. I would just write Pet Store in here. And that worked. Okay. Why did it work? Because I'm not system. Well, that exists. We look at that OpenAPI document again, that operation. I'm not sure why I was allowed to do that. Let's have a look in our. I'm wondering if there's a bug, which means that the subject, when I did that put, I wasn't expecting this to work. What I might do is have a look at that post to this resources. It's here. Okay. I was just installing the resource. Okay, I was installing the resources. Okay. So my thought processes are that I think this is a way of transactionally installing these resources. It converts all of the installers into transaction operations, but at no point does it check that each operation is possible to be complete. It's not doing a permissions check. Which is fine because this install is a pretty privileged command, but nonetheless, the caller of this install should have permission to do every operation that happens as a result of this install. And by putting that check in, it will make this install a lot more powerful. Because it can be, this install can then be given to developers, and to, you know, that, as it stands right now, it's a very, very powerful command because it doesn't have any security checks. API calls do. This at the moment needs to have some algorithm that will say, right, I look at this across this transaction, I see these operations, you need to be able to do them all. There needs to be some check that happens. Yeah, well, I've got pretty good clues to how to write that, but that has to happen. But anyway, well, that was fun. I'm gonna just check in what I've done, because I'm just, and we will see you next time. Yes, thanks for watching. That was quite a good, how long were we? About an hour and a half. I hope that was, at least the beginning was useful to see what it's like to work quite deeply inside. The idea is that we're gradually getting up to a level where we'll be able to do development of APIs in IDEs. You know, that's what you really want to be able to do. And you have some sort of integration where you can make a change to it and you can see everything that's happened, and maybe some VS Code plugins or something. But the whole experience of developing operations should be quite nice. And the experience of developing an API against those operations should be lovely. But you know, there's quite a lot more sanding of the smooth edges to do. And but you know, the core of site is, as you can see, very, very consistently been built. There's a real transactional underpinnings of everything that it does. I'm very excited by how powerful it is as a platform for writing codes, how flexible it is, especially with the Psi language behind it. Really, it allows you to create an API operation that can do more or less anything. You'd be able to do, you know, calls to other services. You'd be able to put things in other databases, and all kinds of that. It's just a question of defining what needs to be possible and putting that into the API of the underlying API that Psi provides to its operation programs. Anyway, that was good. Thank you for watching, and see you again next time.